that concludes the court's explanation of the legal aspects of this case. And now, members of the jury, I come to my final instructions to you. Murder, premeditated homicide is the most serious charge tried in our criminal code. You have listened to the testimony and you have had law read to you and interpreted as it applies to this case. It becomes your duty to try and separate facts from the fancy. One man is dead and life of another is at stake. I urge you to deliberate honestly and thoughtfully. If there is reason to doubt, then you must bring me the verdict of not guilty. If, however, there is no reasonable doubt, then you must in good conscience find the accused guilty. The verdict must be unanimous.
All right, people, let's take seats. Okay, see, this better be fast. I have to be at my son's basketball game.
I think it's reasonable to sit according to number.
Okay, let's get this on the road.
It's pretty tough to figure. A kid kills his father, just like that.
Well, if you analyze the figures...
What figures? It's those people. I'm telling you, they let their kids run wild up there. Well, maybe it serves them right. Know what I mean?
Okay, let's not get ahead of ourselves. I'm not going to have any rules. If you want to discuss it first, then what? That's one way. Or we can vote right now to see where we actually stand.
I think we should vote first.
It's up to you. Just remember, we have got a first degree murder charge here. If we vote guilty, we send the accused to the row. That's sure.
We all know that.
Alright then. This has to be a 12 votes to nothing either way. That's the law. All those voting for guilty, please raise your hands. Okay, 11 to 1 guilty. Now, we know where we stand.
Okay, so what do we do now?
I guess we talk. That man, he's just 18 years old.
Well, that's old enough. He knifed his own father. 4 inches into the chest, man. It's one of those open and shut things. They proved it a dozen different ways. Would you like me to list them for you?
No, I just want to talk.
Well, what's there to talk about? Nobody had think twice about it except you. Why would you say not guilty?
There were 11 votes for guilty. It's not easy for me to, you know, raise my hand and send a boy off to die without even thinking about it first.
Wait, what? Just because I voted first? No. I think the guy is guilty. You couldn't change my mind even if you talked for 100 years. Okay?
I'm not trying to change your mind. It's just that we're talking about someone's life here. I mean, we can't decide in just 5 minutes. What if we all are wrong?
Oh, suppose we are wrong. Suppose this whole building fell on my head. You can suppose anything.
That's right. I can suppose anything I want.
Okay. Then tell me, what are we sitting here for then?
Maybe for no reason. I don't know. Look, that boy's been kicked around all his life. He spent his childhood in a slum, and then his mother died when he was just 9 years old, and then he spent more than 1 year in an orphanage when his father was in prison for forgery. Look, that's not a very good head start. That boy has had a pretty rough 18 years. I think we owe him a few words. That's all.
I don't mind telling you this, but we don't owe him a thing. He got a fair trial. What's the cost of a trial? He's lucky he got it. Know what I mean? Look, we are all grown-ups here. We all heard the facts. And now, you're not going to tell us that we are supposed to believe that kid knowing what he is. Listen, I've lived among them all my life. You can't believe a single word they say. You know that. I mean, they're born liars.
You are an arrogant man.
I don't think arguing out like this is going to do us any good. If we are going to discuss this case, let's stick to the facts.
I think that's a good point. Maybe the gentleman who is disagreeing down there could tell us why. Tell us what you think. We could show him where he is probably mixed up.
Well, look, there is an idea. Maybe I'm thinking out loud, but it seems to me that it's up to us to convince this gentleman here that he is wrong and we are right. Maybe each of us can take a minute or two to explain that. I mean, it's just a thought.
I think it's a good one. Suppose we go around the table. How about you go first?
Well, it's hard to put into words. I just think he's guilty. It was obvious. Nobody proved otherwise.
Okay. Here's what I think. I have no personal feeling about this. I am talking facts. Number one, let's take the old man who lived underneath the room where the murder took place. He said at the night of the killing, he heard a loud noise from the apartment and he said it sounded like a fight. Then he heard the kids shout out, "I am going to kill you." A second later, he heard a body fall on the floor and then he ran to the door of his house and saw the kid running out downstairs and out of the house. And then he called the police and they found the father with a knife in his chest.
And the coroner fixed time of death around midnight.
It was obvious to me. Anyway, the boy's entire story was flimsy. He claimed that he was at the movies at the time of the killing, yet 1 hour later, he couldn't remember what movie he saw or who played in them. And no one saw him in and out of the theater.
What about the woman across the street? If her testimony doesn't prove it, nothing does.
Let's go in order here.
Just a minute. Here's a woman lying in bed and can't sleep. She's dying with the heat. She looks out of a window right across the train tracks and sees the kid stick the knife right into his father. The time was 12 midnight. Everything fits, okay? Look, she's known the kid all his life. Her window is right opposite to his. And she swore she saw him do it.
Through the windows of a passing electric train.
Right. This electric train had no passengers on it. It was just being moved downtown. And the lights were out. They even proved in court that you could look through the windows of an electric train when the lights are out.
I would like to ask you something. You say you don't believe the boy. How can you believe that woman? She's one of them too, isn't she? Those people who live in the slums?
You're a pretty smart fellow, aren't you?
Okay, let's keep things peaceful here. Whose turn is it?
I'll pass.
Okay, I'll go. Well, I started to be convinced pretty early in this case. I was just looking for a moment. I mean, if there is no more to rest the case. So, anyways. That testimony from the people across the hall of the boys' apartment, that was so strong. So, didn't they say something about an argument between the father and the son that night at 8? I mean, I could be wrong.
Right, they heard an argument, but they couldn't hear what it was about. And then they heard the father hit the boy twice, and finally they saw the boy walking angrily out of the house. What does that prove?
No, it doesn't. Part of the picture, I didn't say it
proved
something.
You said it revealed a motive for the killing. The prosecuting attorney said the same thing. Well, I don't think it's a very strong motive. The boy has been hit so many times in his life that violence is practically a normal state of affairs for him. I can't see two slaps in the face provoking him into committing murder.
How about the next?
I don't know, it's practically all said. Look at his record. He was in children's court when he was 10 for throwing a rock at his teacher. At 14, he was in reform school. He stole a car. He's been arrested for mugging. He was picked up twice for trying to slash another teenager with a knife. He is real quick with switching knives.
I think we are missing the point here. The boy, let's say, is a product of filthy neighborhood and a broken home. We can't help that. We are here to decide whether he is guilty or not. He was born in slums. The slums are the breeding grounds for criminals. It's obvious to me, and I think it's so do you know it. Children from slums background are potential menace to the society.
I have lived in a slum all my life. I nurse the trash in Harlem Hospital 6 nights a week.
Now let's be more reasonable. There's nothing personal. Please stop this. It's your turn. You go.
I thought you were all supposed to be convincing me. Well, I haven't got anything brilliant. I only know as much as you guys do. According to the testimony, it looks like the boy is guilty. I had a few questions to ask. Maybe they don't mean anything, I don't know. But I felt like the defense counsel wasn't doing his job. He let too many things go. Or maybe it's also possible for a lawyer to be just plain stupid.
You sound like you just met my brother.
If I had been in his place, I would have asked for another lawyer. It's my life trial after all. I would have wanted my lawyer to shred the prosecution witnesses to pieces. Look, there was one eyewitness and another heard the killing and then saw the boy run. Suppose they were wrong?
Suppose they are wrong. Then what's the point of having witnesses at all?
They are people after all. People can make mistakes.
I mean, nobody can stop that from happening, right? This isn't an exact science.
Let's get to the point. What about a switch knife on the father's chest? You know, right, that one fine upright word agreed to bind that one night of a murder.
Okay, let's get it in here and talk about it. Foreman?
Alright, we all noted how the knife looks.
This gentleman has the right to see exhibits and evidence. Let's go through all the facts once.
Okay.
The boy admitted going out of his house at 8 after being hit by his father several times. After, he went to the neighborhood shop to buy a, what's it called?
A switchable knife.
Right, thank you. Now this is a very unique knife. The shopkeeper said that it is a one-of-a-kind knife. Now back to the lad. At about 8:45, he ran into three of his friends in front of the diner. Am I correct?
Yes, you are.
All those friends who saw him with that particular knife admitted in court that the murder weapons look exactly the same. Now this lad, who spent about an hour with his friends, came back home at 10. This is where the prosecution story and the boy story began to diverge. He claims that he stayed home at 11. He stayed home till 11:30, then went to the one of those all-nighter movies, came back home at 3:15, and then saw his father dead. What about the switchable knife? Now this is an imaginative and charming fable he invented. He claims that the knife fell through a hole in his pocket somewhere around 11:30 and 3:15 on his way to the movies, and he never saw it again. Quite evidently, gentlemen, I think the boy never went to the movies. Nobody in the theater identifies him, and he didn't even remember the names of the movies he saw. Now what actually happened is this. The boy stayed home, had another fight with his father, stabbed him to death 10 minutes after 12, and he even remembers to wipe the fingerprints off. Are you trying to tell me that it fell through a hole in his pocket, somebody picked it up off the street, went to the boy's home, killed his father, just to be amusing?
No, I'm saying it's possible that the boy lost the knife and someone else stabbed his father with a similar knife. It's possible, right?
Now, take a look at that knife. I've never seen another one like it, nor the shopkeeper. So at this point, are you asking us to accept a pretty incredible coincidence?
I'm not asking you to accept anything. I'm just saying that it's possible.
And I am saying that is not possible.
I went for a walk last night, you know, just thinking, when I came across this little pawn shop. It's 3 blocks away from the boy's house. The knife cost me $6.
It is against the law to buy or sell switchable knives without a permit.
That's right, I broke the law.
What do you think that proves? Maybe there are 10 knives like that. So what? What does that mean? Discovery of age or something?
It would still be an incredible coincidence for another person to have stabbed the father with the same knife.
The odds are a million to one.
But it's still possible.
It's quite interesting that he is able to find the same kind of knife.
What's interesting? Do you think that proves anything?
Well, no. I was just...
How come the boy bought the knife at the first place? Oh yeah, he was gonna give it as a present for a friend of his next day because he busted the other kid's knife by dropping it on the pavement.
That's what he said.
The friend has testified that the boy did break his knife.
How long before the murder? 3 weeks? So now you tell me how our noble lad bought the knife 1.5 hours before his father smacked him, and 3.5 hours later they found it soaked up there in the father's chest.
Well, he was going to give it as a present, and I think he wanted to try it out first.
Let me ask you this. If the boy bought the knife to use it on his father, then why did he show it to his 3 friends just 2 hours before the killing took place?
Well, all of that is just talks. The boy is lied. We all know that.
Do you think he lied?
Yeah, that's a stupid question. I'm sure he lied.
How about you?
I'm not sure enough.
Who are you? The kid's lawyer or something? Who do you think you are? To come in here and start cross-examining us?
Isn't that supposed to happen in a jury room?
What do you think you want to accomplish? If you want to be a stubborn and hang this jury, then go on. But this kid been tried again and found guilty, just as sure as he was born.
I think we should vote on this again.
I think a ballot would be good. Guilty, 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 not guilty, guilty.
Another chap flips his wig.
Alright, who was it? Come on, I want to know.
But this was supposed to be a secret ballot, right?
Alright, let's calm down.
Calm down? What are you telling? We are trying to put a guilty man into the chair where he belongs, and all of a sudden somebody came in and started telling us fairy tales, and we are listening this.
Now please stop yelling. Now who got some constructive points to add?
Please, I would like to add something. I've always thought that in this country, a man is entitled to an unpopular opinion.
Let's stick to the subject. What made you change your mind?
He didn't change his vote. I did. Would you like me to tell you why?
No, I would not.
Too bad. I'll say it nevertheless. This gentleman has been standing alone against us. He never said anything about the boy being not guilty. He just isn't sure enough. He gambled for support and I gave it to him. I respect his motives. The boy probably is guilty, but I just want to hear more.
This might be a small point, but anyways, the boy had a motive to kill, I mean, the beatings and all. But who else had a motive? Like, no one just goes out, kills someone unless they're playing nuts.
Now that's a reasonable question. We can't help asking ourselves who else might have had a motive. Logically, these things follow. If it wasn't the boy, then who was it?
I don't know about that, but his father wasn't someone you'd call a model citizen, right? The boy's lawyer outlined his background in his closing statement. He said that his father was a gambling freak. He had been in prison and he was known to be a pretty consistent loser. He used to be in bars and pick up fights with men after just 2 drinks. He was a tough, cruel, primitive kind of man. He could have been murdered by any of the men he had beaten, or one of the men he had been in prison with, or a woman he had picked upon. It could be anyone, I mean.
Then please answer this for me. Please. An old man who lived downstairs, he heard a kid shout out, "I am going to kill you." Okay. And a split second later, he heard a body hit on the floor. And then he saw the boy run out of the house. What did that all mean to you? Nothing?
I was wondering how he clearly heard all that through the ceiling.
Not through the ceiling. The window was open. So why the window upstairs? It was a hot night. You remember?
Still, the voice came from another apartment. It's not easy to recognize a voice coming from some other house. Especially a shouting one.
Actually, he identified in the code. Blindfolded from 5 other voices.
That was just an ambitious district attorney putting on a show. Look, the old man knows the boy's voice pretty well. They've lived together for so many years. But to identify it positively from an apartment downstairs? Isn't it possible that the old man just thought the boy was upstairs and automatically decided that he heard the boy's voice? Isn't that possible?
Look, the old man heard the father's body falling and then he saw the boy run out 15 seconds later. He saw the boy.
Listen, I was just wondering, maybe we shouldn't take another vote.
Let's call an open bullet. I wonder who stands where?
Alright, that's fair. Now I vote guilty. Now 6-6.
6-6? Are you guys out of your mind? A kid like that!
The point is, facts are supposed to make the case, and they can be twisted.
No, how do you know that? You can't prove that.
Come on! You guys are forgetting the details! You bunch of pseudo-intellectuals! You're just like everybody else. You think too much that you get mixed up.
Now listen, you can't say that to people.
The hell with this. We'll be here all night. I don't care what happens to him. What am I gonna do? Break my brains over a scum like that?
That's ridiculous and dishonest. You are under oath. Why you vote not guilty?
Alright, let's stop this. We are not going to get anywhere like this.
It's my honest opinion that he's guilty.
Let me remind you that the boy couldn't even remember the name or the actors of the movie he claims he went for watching during the hours of the crime. The prosecution pointed this out and held it in his contempt.
That's correct. The boy couldn't back up any details of his alibi.
If you were the boy, do you think you would remember such details after seeing your father murdered? The cops questioned him right in the kitchen while the body was lying on the bedroom floor.
I think so. Even under great emotional stress, he might not have been to the cinemas.
He was able to name the details in the court.
He had 3 months till the trial to memorize the details.
I would like to ask you a personal question. Where were you 2 nights ago?
That was Tuesday. Oh yes, I was attending a bridge tournament.
And what about Monday night?
Me and my wife went to the movies, the PVR.
Okay. What was the second feature and who starred in it?
The coolie number one. The pretty girl Sara Khanna or something like that was the star.
Who else?
Well, it was a cheap second feature with the unknown.
You were not under emotional strain, were you?
No, I wasn't.
I think the point is made.
Big point. So does it prove the kid was at the movies?
It is a big point, in fact. It indicates that no one can prove he wasn't. If a perfectly normal lady can forget what she saw, so can a boy who is being accused of his father's murder.
Say what you want. The boy is guilty. Period.
I was thinking, what kid psychiatrist said?
Don't even start with that phony psych, whatever you call it stuff. It's all junk. I know 3 psychiatrists and all 3 of them are crazy. You can't value their testimony.
Why don't you let the man talk? You can continue after he's finished.
The doctor proved with empirical evidences that the boy was a killer type. The boy always had some homicidal tendencies.
Check. Paranoid tendencies on its subconscious mind. Foreman, nobody else's.
Look, many people are capable of committing a murder, but only a few fraction of people actually commit. And the test only shows the abilities of a person, of what he is capable of. It doesn't prove anything. And to say a man is capable of committing a murder is different from he has actually committed one.
Listen, they said the kid is capable. He could have killed. Couldn't he?
But you were the one who said you can't value their testimony.
Say, could I see that knife for a second? The stab wound. It was done with a downward angle, you know. The boy was 5 feet and 7 inches tall. His father was 6 feet 2. It's very awkward to stab down someone's chest when they're like 7 inches taller.
Someone come up here and help me demonstrate, man. This is the first and last time I am doing this. So watch this carefully, all of you. Now look. So as of now, I am 5 or 6 inches shorter than you. And look at this angle. That's how the boy did.
Really? You think all this is funny?
Calm down, Yuva. Nobody is hurt. And here you see is your angle. And that's how a short man stabs a taller one. And that's how the boy did. Okay. And you, why don't you go ahead and tell me that I am still wrong?
Down in. No need to further argument, I guess.
Wait a minute. Hand over the knife to me. Yeah. I grew up with these knives, you know. You see, these switch knives came with my neighborhood. They were everywhere back then. Beat a lot across my street, my stoop and my own backyard. I just try to forget about them, but these switch knives can't be used that way, from what I know. You use it underhanded. So in order to stab someone downwards, you have to change grip. And anyone who has ever handled a switch knife won't use it any other way.
Are you sure about this?
Yes, absolutely. That's the reason they are made like this.
So now that everybody agrees that the boy was pretty handy with a knife, do you think he was capable of making that wound which killed his father?
No, I don't think so. With the kind of experience he has with these things, he would have gone for him underhanded.
How do you know that? Were you there in the room when the father was killed?
No, but neither was anyone else, right?
From what I think, you really can't determine the type of wound the lad can make based on the experience he has with knife.
Well said. Absolutely right.
Wait, I will tell you something. I'm really, really sick of all this, all nonsense, all this bickering won't lead us anywhere. I'll break it up here and I change my vote to not guilty. Okay.
You what? That's not an answer, sir.
Hey, you just worry about yourself, not me, okay?
Oh, he's absolutely right. What kind of man are you? First you weighed some baseball tickets over that young boy's life and voted guilty. And now you're changing it back to not guilty just because you had enough of talking. Do you have any respect for that man's life? What an inhuman thing to do.
Wait, hold up. Who do you think gave you the right to talk to me like that?
You know what? I can and will talk to you like this. Vote not guilty if you're convinced. Not because you've had enough of it. You can simply vote guilty if you feel like that. Or do you like the sincerity of doing what is right? So, guilty or not guilty?
I told you, right? Not guilty.
But why? Say it.
To hell with you, man. Well, because I don't think he's guilty.
Mr. Foreman, I want a re-vote.
All in favor of not guilty, now please raise your hands.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. And now all those who vote guilty? Yeah, so it's 10, 9 to 3 in favor of not guilty.
What's wrong with you people? And what useless little details do you keep bringing up? How can you believe anything this scum says? You look like an intelligent man who knows the facts of life. And don't you dare tell me otherwise. For God's sake, what makes you think you can believe his story? And as for this guy, I don't know what's wrong with him. He who talks about psychiatrists probably needs one for himself. Let's all talk facts here. These people are liars, and any man in his senses will agree to that. The truth is, they act different and think different. An example being, they hardly need a motive to kill anyone. They are just drunkards drowning themselves in cheap wine all day. What's with them slamming the door like that? Anyways, these men get drunk and boom, all of a sudden, there's a dead body on the floor. And they're not to be blamed because that's just how their nature is. Violent. The value of human life for them is not the same as it's for us.
Do you have any idea of how sick you sound?
You old fool! How dare you? Take your hands off me. How the hell did you say that? You can hardly stand and you call me sick? Let me just talk my part and you stay shut and listen.
We should all remain calm.
To hell with being calm. There's not even one among them who's good. Not even one, you hear me? Now let me lay it out all for you, you stupid, ignorant bastards. You, at the window, who's so goddamn smart. Can't you see the danger we are facing? How these people, just like this kid, are multiplying 5 times faster than us, as per the stats. And these men, who are no better than the wild animals, hate us. They want to destroy us. You hear me? What makes you look at me like that? Can't you simply understand the dangerous times we are living in now? If we don't watch it and smack them down whenever it's possible, we'll be bred out of existence, you idiots.
Oh man, did you just shut up?
You self-pronounced geniuses. Listen to me. They are vicious, violent, and ignorant. They'll cut us up one day, I'm telling you. That is their intent. We have got this boy here. At least one of their kind. Let's get him before they destroy us all. I don't care about the law. And why should I when these people don't? I'm telling you. Listen to me, for God's sake.
I have heard enough. Stop your filthy mouth now.
You smart little bastard. Why don't you tell us where did you get that girl?
That's enough. It's very difficult to keep personal prejudice out of a thing like this. And prejudice obscures the truth. But the thing here is, we don't really know what's the truth. And perhaps we might never know. 9 of us here believe that the boy is not guilty. But we might as well be shooting in the dark. We can be wrong. We might end up sending a murderer back into the community. So we may be wrong, you know. But the thing is, we have some reasonable doubt. And that reasonable doubt carries enormous value in our system. You can't just send a man to his death without being sure. Perhaps the 3 of you can tell us how you are so sure of him being guilty.
I'll try. Firstly, I must agree that you've made some excellent point. Especially the one wherein you prove the overhand wound wouldn't have been the lad's doom. But there are still 2 reasons which make me believe the boy is still guilty. First being the evidence provided by the woman across the street who saw the murder being committed.
Rightly said, brother. And indeed, it was the most important testimony in the entire case.
Secondly, the woman described the murderer raising the knife over his head and saw him plunge it down to the father's chest. So, as to say, she saw him do it the wrong way.
That's absolutely correct.
Now talking of this woman, she went to sleep at 11. Her bed was right next to the window and she could clearly see the boy's window across the street. So she tossed and turned that night for over an hour, unable to sleep. And about 10 minutes after 12, she could see the murder happening through the window of the passing L trains. She said that the lights went out immediately, but she could clearly see that the boy killed his father. And that to me is a solid testimony. What do you think? I personally don't have a reason for acquittal. What about you?
It seems very complicated to me. You see, all these evidence to shift and things like that. Actually, it's very, very, very complicated to arrange those facts in order, you see.
I think we should go over all the facts again. Haven't we ended already? Sir, Hero Hiralal is bouncing here and they are like a tennis ball. Okay, I beg you, please now let's get done with this thing.
Okay, maybe we can talk again, setting some kind of a time limit. The time is 5:45. Oh. Okay. At 7 o'clock, we will start discuss whether the question that we are a hung jury or not.
Don't you feel well?
I feel perfectly well, thank you.
The reason I asked about that is you were rubbing your nose, and sorry to interrupt you, but that just reminded me of something familiar and important. And I was wondering why you were rubbing your nose like that.
Well, if it is your business to worry why I'm rubbing my nose, it is because it bothers me.
I'm sorry. Is it because of your eyeglasses? Your eyeglasses seem to make those deep impressions on the sides of your nose, right? I hadn't noticed that earlier. They must be annoying.
Yes, they are annoying.
The woman who testified that she saw the killings had these similar marks on the sides of her nose. Just a minute, let me complete. I don't know if anyone noticed, but she had the similar marks and she kept on rubbing them in the court.
Yeah, he's right. She did do that a lot.
The woman was about 45 years old, but she was making tremendous effort to look 35 for her first public appearance. Dyed hair, branded clothes, no eyeglasses, if you can get her mental picture.
What do you mean no eyeglasses? You don't know if she wears glasses? You suggest because she is rubbing her eyes?
I saw them. She has those marks.
See, I dyed her hair, had marks on nose. What point you are trying to make? What does it all mean?
Could those marks be anything other than eyeglasses?
No, they couldn't. Yes, I saw them too. Strange. I didn't thought about it before.
What about the lawyer? What about the district attorney? Why didn't they say anything? Do you think he would try to pull a trick like that, have her testify without glasses?
You ever know a woman who had glasses but didn't want to wear them while stepping out because that would spoil her looks? Maybe the district attorney didn't know either.
Okay, I will give you that. She would not wear glasses when she's stepping out of the house. But during the murder, she was at her home alone. That's all.
Do you wear glasses when you go to bed?
I don't. Nobody wears eyeglasses to bed.
So, is it logical to say that she was not wearing glasses while she was in bed trying to fall asleep?
How do you know that?
I don't know. I'm just guessing. As she herself said that she saw the murder happening just when she looked out of the window, and then a split second later the lights went out. So she might not have had the time to put the glasses on. She could have honestly seen the boy killing the man, but I say she saw a blur.
How do you know what she saw? She may be farsighted. You don't know what kind of glasses she wears. They may be sunglasses. How do you know about it?
I only know that the woman's eyesight is in question now.
You can't send someone off to die on evidence like that.
Don't give me that.
Don't you think that the woman might have made a mistake? Is it not possible?
No, it is not possible.
Is it not possible?
Yes, it's possible. I vote not guilty.
Do you think he's guilty?
Yes. I think he is guilty. But I couldn't care less. You smart bastards do whatever you want. I vote not guilty.
You son of a... I think he is guilty.
I'm convinced. I have a reasonable doubt. I vote not guilty.
So now it is 11 to 1.
Well, what about the other stuff? The knife?
You said we can throw out all of the evidence.
Now you are alone.
I don't care if I am alone or not. It is my right. What do you all want? I say he is guilty.
We want your arguments.
I already gave you my arguments.
We are not convinced. We want to hear them again.
Every single thing that come out in the courtroom proves that he is guilty. Do you think I am an idiot or something? You are not going to intimidate me. I am entitled to my opinion and I can sit in this goddamn room for a year. Wait, what about the old man who lived there and he had everything? Or the knife? Just because one found something like that, the old man saw him, man. What is the difference and how many seconds it took? Every single thing that has been twisted and turned in here. What is the case with the glasses? The woman testified in the court. That's it.
He's not your boy. He's somebody else's.
Let him live.
Alright. Not guilty.
Okay. The verdict is ready.